Brown Tech, yes, City, we have been known to delve into the wonderful and magical land of the Xeon. And today, we have our friend, the 1680 V2. And this is a CPU that was made back in 2013. 8 cores, 16 threads, and it was overclockable. And it's such a special CPU, not just because it's a Xeon, but also because there was no i7 equivalent out on the X79 lineup, where the maximum core and thread count you could get with the i7s was 6 cores, 12 threads. Though nowadays you can pick this Xeon up for around $200 US. And the best thing about today's video is I literally pulled the motherboard I'm using in today's comparison out of a dumpster. And then I bent some pins back and we got it working. And the best thing is we're overclocking quite well. So we've got this CPU up to 4.6 gigahertz overclock, up from its 3 gigahertz base clock. And these numbers that you're going to see today still show that the old school Xeons are nothing to laugh at, where we're coupling it with a 2080 Ti and we're also giving it quad channel DDR3 2133 megahertz XMP memory versus the 3950X with its 3600 megahertz CL16 and also the 10900K with its CL16 3600 megahertz. So enough talk, it's time for the return of the Xeon.
Hey dude, I love paying $200 for a Windows 10 Pro license.
Said no one.
Today's video sponsor, SCD Keys, has you covered with a cheap Windows 10 Pro OEM single end user license using the TYC coupon code. You can get this for as little as $13 USD. Links in the description below. So moving into these results, we've got overclocks on the 10900K, 5.2 gigahertz all core. Then we move over to the 3950X, we've got a overclock of 4.4 gigahertz all core. And then we move over to the 1680 V2, as we said in the intro, 4.6 gigahertz all core. Now we use the same CPU cooler across the board. This is the H115i RGB Platinum. And without further ado, let's look at these results. Pulling up Shadow of the Tomb Raider, 1080p high settings, DirectX 12. We can see here the 10900K does pull ahead of the competition quite substantially here, getting 170 average FPS versus 138 and 133. Now, something interesting about Shadow of the Tomb Raider, I'm not used to seeing FPS this high, so something must have happened recently with this game that allowed, I guess, the 10900K in particular to do a lot better than I've previously seen with it. But another thing I have done with the Intel CPUs is I have disabled Spectre and Meltdown. And also on the AMD side, that's automatically immune to Meltdown. And then for the Spectre protection, I leave that enabled actually, because I find it gives it better FPS. So for Shadow of the Tomb Raider, the 1680 V2 did lose out by a little bit. However, that being said, we move on to the Division 2, and here we saw a slight victory for the 1680 V2 versus the 3950X, and then the 10900K pulled out ahead. But it wasn't by a whole lot, and this is a 1080p setting with a 2080 Ti. But the Xeon didn't want to just stop there, it wanted to show the world that it's still capable of booging. And Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon, we scored some impressive results here with 175 average FPS versus 171 on the 3950X versus 203 on the 10900K. Then we move over to Warzone, where we got 201 with 110 1% and 0.1% lows with 88 on the 10900K versus 187, 93 and 75 on the 3950X versus 195, 95 and 78. On the Xeon. Now, another thing about the Warzone settings, this time around, I did change them to what I consider, or at least what I researched, was competitive settings. We've got high textures and also anisotropic filtering on high, but a lot of the other stuff is on low, but you also up the field of view to 100, which is what most pro streamers use. Though the next game up here, we've got a special for you guys, Grounded, not yet released, but I've got early access to this game, so I'm able to test it for you guys. And we've got here the 10900K scoring 102 at 1080p high settings with good 1% 0.1% lows. Same for the 3950X, that did well. And also the Xeon did very impressive here too, scoring 97, 81, and 58. The last game we're pulling up for you guys is Fortnite, where the 10900K decided it wanted to scream ahead with 540 average FPS with the 1% lows pretty much matching that, and actually higher than that of the Xeon and matching that of the 3950X with 362 average FPS versus 339. So with those numbers out of the way, a CPU from 2013, given the right circumstances, given the right memory, because if we're putting this high powered memory on the newest and latest and greatest Intel and Ryzen systems, we should do the same for the older Xeon. And doing so showed that this quad channel 1680 V2 does do an impressive job even in 2020. And it goes to show, if you can find someone just giving away or selling an X79 motherboard for virtually nothing, and say for instance you can find a good CPU cooler on sale, then nothing's stopping you from getting really good FPS out of the old school stuff. And honestly, for the 1680 V2, even though it doesn't have the latest AVX2 instruction sets, most of these games here, it was showing that it was performing extremely well. And I was actually blown away by the performance of this CPU. Granted, the Xeons do need a lot more tuning and manual overclocking than the 3950X and also the 10900K. But I guess in ways that is the beauty of some of this older gear, that out of the box, it's sort of a bit dormant, but once you start giving it throttle, it really responds, and it responds in a big manner. The one thing I will say is, in the case of the 10900K and the 1680 V2, is once you start moving up to these really high clock speeds, the power consumption does go up. And we can see this in Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon, where I'm testing the power consumption here, and it's going around 400 watts for the 10900K, going up to a maximum of 398 watts. And then on the Ryzen system, we're scoring 351 watts. And then on the Xeon, we went up to 465 watts. So the old school X79 stuff does juice a bit more power, especially when you're gaming. But of course, if you pick it up cheap enough and power doesn't cost a whole lot where you live, then something like this may be a good consideration if you're looking to build the best price performance high-end gaming rig in 2020. Now, of course, it is used, and there is the risk of anything used not working 100% or having some weird problem. But I find most of the time with used deals, as long as you scope it out and you see it tested and working before you get it, or you get some kind of confirmation that the parts work properly, then you're usually in good hands. Now, one more thing with the 1680 V2 is that it doesn't support the latest AVX2 instruction sets. So what this means is that if some game or some program comes out in the future that requires AVX2, or it works a lot better with AVX2, then the 1680 V2 Xeon will fall behind against its newer counterparts. And a perfect example of this is Cinebench R20. Even though it's a synthetic benchmark, it does highlight the differences between the maximum theoretical performance of the 10900K versus the 3950X versus the 1680 V2, where the 3950X with its 16 cores, 32 threads is really geared up in a different league for productivity than these other two CPUs. And then of course the 10900K is also in a different league compared to the 1680 V2 if you need productivity with AVX2. Anyhow, with all that out of the way, if you guys enjoyed today's Xeon Showdown versus the latest and greatest, then be sure to hit that like button. Also let us know in the comment section below what you think of the older Xeons, as I love reading your thoughts and opinions as always. And don't worry, when you guys keep messaging me in the comments, spamming video after video that you want to see more Xeons, I hear loud and clearly. And also we've got the question of the day, which comes from Helios Genosis, and they ask, did something happen to your channel, mate? I have been subscribed for a while and I look just now and I see the option to join. What the? Your channel is in my home screen subscribe channel list. Also, to add to that weirdness, by the way, maybe you should do a channel update. I know sometimes YouTube does weird mass unsubs on people. Join as in sub, not join premium, by the way, to clear any confusion that may cause, if any. And this is one thing that I notice along my channel. It happens, I'd say, like 2 or 3 times a year, where it seems like we're doing really well, everything's going great, and then all of a sudden it's like, woo! And I don't know what's going on. I have messaged YouTube in the past when people have commented and say, hey, the videos aren't showing up on the sub feed. And I have no idea what it is. And I've tried to figure it out for years now, and it just seems like whatever. But that's like in life, that's just how things go. But ultimately, I don't really know what's going on there. I'll probably message YouTube and see if they know what's up with that. In the meantime, if you do get unsubscribed and you're enjoying the content, then make sure you hit that sub button and ring that bell, and you'll get that content as soon as it drops in your sub box. And also let us know in the comments too, are you enjoying me shooting on Panasonic again? This was done on the G8X, which I picked up on a bargain. I'm gonna end up getting this camera for like $50 Aussie. And if you guys wanna hear how, I'll talk about that in the used parts hunt of the month. And this is the Cinelike V profile, which I have sorely missed. I changed over to Sony for cameras and filming, and now I'm kind of thinking about changing back to Panasonic. So do let us know in the comments if you enjoyed this picture. And with that aside, I'll catch you guys in another tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.